Today we're going to talk about the major stages of getting your ex back. Now specifically, we're going to be looking at 8 stages, which are the following. The no contact stage, the attachment gravity stage, the crossroads stage, the texting stage, the phone call stage, the meetup stage, the romantic date stage, and the asking for a commitment stage. Now the stages are meant to be done in order. So one of the biggest issues that we see most of our clients kind of exhibiting is they understand how each of the stages will work, usually through a video like this or through our program. And then when they actually get into the stages, they want to skip ahead because they want results quicker. The way this kind of works is you're supposed to do it in order. So keep that in mind as I go through each of these stages. Let's just jump right in. Stage number 1, the no contact rule stage. So without a doubt, this is probably the most popular stage that anyone who isn't familiar with the ex recovery program, who is just kind of generally looking at breakups, will probably have heard about the no contact rule. But perhaps where we take a bit of a different approach is in our actual definition of the no contact. So originally, most people think of the no contact rule as this period of time where you're supposed to ignore your ex to make them miss you, to almost like manipulate them into liking you. Well, we found that while it can have that added benefit of psychologically making an ex want you, or you know, the absence makes the heart grow fonder type of a mentality, we find that the people who tend to do the best during no contact really look at the no contact rule in the following way. Basically, they look at it as this period of time where they cut off all conceivable communication with an ex after a breakup, but the intent of doing this should not be used to make an ex miss you. Instead, it should be used to rebuild your own life so that you can outgrow your ex. And the irony is by doing this, the no contact rule can have that added benefit of making an ex miss you. So generally speaking, if you're going through a breakup, either you broke up with your ex or they broke up with you, the first stage of getting them back is always the same. It is literally to do a no contact rule, but also reshift your paradigm into thinking this isn't going to be something I use to get my ex back and make them miss me, but rather it's going to be used to help me grow as a human being so that I can kind of outgrow the relationship. Don't worry, all the fun stuff will come a little bit later. Let's move on to stage number 2. Stage 2, the attachment gravity stage. All right, so really what you need to understand about this is kind of understanding the 4 basic attachment styles, right? So you have the securely attached person, which is like the healthiest person. You know, when they go through a breakup, they allow themselves time to grieve and eventually kind of move past the breakup in a healthy way. Then, of course, you have the anxiously attached person. This is an insecure attachment, and usually people who have this attachment put too much of themselves into relationships and are prone to begging for an ex back and other common anxious behaviors. Then, of course, you have the avoidantly attached person. This is another insecure attachment, yet it's the polar opposite of an anxious attachment style. So generally, someone who's avoidantly attached will classify themselves as someone who values their independence and pushes those away who they deem as threatening their independence. And then finally, you have the fearfully attached person. This is kind of like a combination of the worst anxious behaviors and the worst avoidant behaviors kind of wrapped up into one. So it's literally a worst of both worlds type of a situation. So what is the deal with the attachment gravity stage? Well, this stage is actually going to be going on throughout the entirety of the process, but you're going to start it during the no contact rule, specifically in that time where you're not talking to your ex. You know, you've gone 21 to 45 days of deciding to cut off communication, not talk to them, except in those few specific limited no contact situations. What you're really trying to do is recognize your attachment style, recognize your ex's attachment style, and always move yourself to being more secure. It's a lot easier said than done. But the best way to do this oftentimes is by finding a purpose greater than your ex that you can focus on. Most of the time we're finding that our clients tend to be anxiously attached. And while there are many quote unquote negatives to being anxiously attached, one of the biggest positives is the fact that they are really great problem solvers. And we can see that, you know, when they're in a relationship with someone and that person starts to pull away, their mind immediately goes into how can I fix this so that they don't pull away? They're great problem solvers. So What we need to do during the no contact rule is try to give them a problem outside of their ex that they can solve. And oftentimes I teach women and men how to do that by helping them find a greater purpose than their ex. And the odd part is it's a secure and healthy way of handling the breakup. So generally speaking, what you're trying to do during this attachment stage is literally move your anxious or avoidant attachment style towards being more secure. Stage number three, the crossroads stage. So this is the stage that's typically going to be happening after the no contact rule is completed. So generally speaking, right after the no contact rule has finished and before the texting sort of phase or stage starts. So what is the crossroads stage? Well, generally speaking, the no contact rule is gonna last you anywhere between 21 to 45 days. If you're able to do a full out no contact on your ex, guess what? That means you haven't talked to them in that period of time. You've also spent a lot of your time with sort of self-growth, trying to become more securely attached and things of that nature. The challenge though, and the irony is, sometimes when you do those things, the light bulb goes off on your head and you no longer want your ex back. And of course, the irony is usually it's when you're at that stage that the ex all of a sudden has interest in you again. But here's the crossroads stage in a nutshell. You have a decision to make after the no contact rule is complete. You can either continue forward down the stages and try to get your ex back. No guarantees, of course, this is not an exact science. Or you can decide, you know what? I'm kind of over it. I want to move past my ex. So essentially you are at a crossroads. You can either choose to get your ex back or you can choose to move on from your ex. No matter what you choose, you're going to continue doing the self-growth that you taught yourself how to do after this breakup during the no contact rule throughout the entirety of whatever path you go on. But for the purposes of this video, we're just gonna assume that you want your ex back and you're gonna go down that path. But assuming you didn't want your ex back and you went down the move on path, essentially the stages are done. You've successfully healed or are on the right step towards healing from this breakup. Let's move on towards the next stage, which is the texting stage. Real quick, I wanna say that if you're new to this YouTube channel or you're trying to figure out what you should be doing to get your ex back and you're trying to learn if you even have a chance in your specific circumstance, probably the smartest thing for you to do is actually stop by our website, www.exboyfriendrecovery.com, or take our ex recovery chances quiz that can be found at exboyfriendrecovery.com. Now, if you're watching this on YouTube, taking that free quiz is super easy to do. All you have to simply do is look in the description link below this YouTube video and click on the link you see there. It will take you directly to the quiz where you can fill it out and get an easy answer on what you should be doing going forward and overall what your chances look like in your specific situation. All right, so let's get you back to the video. Stage four, the texting stage. Now, if you're not familiar with my concept of the value ladder, this is probably a perfect time to introduce it. So I came up with this concept originally in 2013 when I started, or rather ex-boyfriend recovery, my website started to get some public attention. Essentially, the value ladder works this way. Imagine the stages of getting your ex back kind of like you're climbing a ladder. Now, if you can get to the top of the ladder, you get your ex back. Yet each rung to get to the top of the ladder requires you to create some type of value with your ex so that your ex actually values the time that you're having together. And that always starts with lower risk type investments. And the perfect low risk type investment, of course, happens with texting. So the texting stage is all about building value with your ex through text messages. Now, I could go on and on and have gone on and on throughout the history of my website, this YouTube channel, the podcast, on how you can properly text an ex and some of the strategies that you can use. I highly recommend you check those resources out if you want a little bit more of an in-depth discussion on that. For now, we're just gonna broadly sum up the texting phase as you are building attraction in a very clever way with your ex through texting. Stage number five, the phone call stage. Much like the texting stage is all about building value with your ex through texting, the phone call stage is about building value with your ex through phone calls. But we're not just gonna limit this to phone calls, because with the advent and popularity of video chat softwares like Zoom, Skype, FaceTime, those are kind of included in the phone call phase. Now, where this kind of gets interesting has something to do with a concept called the 7-38-55 rule. So Dr. Albert Meribon basically argued that really the elements of personal communication could be divided into three distinct categories with the following percentages. 7% of meaning when you communicate with someone through basic word. 38% of meaning can be had through voice or tone. And 55% can be had through body language. So if you haven't figured out what's going on here, we've designed the value ladder in a way that is in accordance with this value concept that Dr. Albert Meribon basically came up with. So the texting phase is only engaging 7% of the potential meaning through communication, because really you're only using written word to communicate back and forth. Whereas the phone call phase is not only incorporating that 7% through written word, but also it's incorporating 38% through voice and your tone of the voice. So essentially what's happening here is the phone call stage is your opportunity to kind of open the world up with your ex again. Again, you're building value through texting still, but you're also sprinkling in phone call conversations during this phase. And the entire point of this is to get to in-person interactions so that you don't get rejected when that time comes. Stage number 6, the meetup stage. So let's talk a little bit about the meetup stage and why I kind of consider it to be different than the romantic date stage. Now, I mentioned at the beginning of this video that the number one mistake we see people having when we explain these 8 stages to them is essentially they want to get right to the romantic date stage. And it really is understandable, because it's really hard when you have all of this history with an ex where you've been romantic, you've been potentially intimate together, to all of a sudden have to slow down on purpose. Well, unfortunately, that slowing down on purpose concept is still gonna be happening even when you make it to the in-person interaction stage, and that starts with meetups. So think of it like this. There are 3 types of dates. You have the small dates, which are kind of considered meetups. You have the medium dates, which are kind of in between a meetup and a romantic date. And then finally you have the large dates, which are the romantic dates. Everything we're doing is building towards that romantic date, but again, you're gonna slowly stair step your way to that. And that really starts with meetups. So rather than going on this incredibly romantic date immediately after you kind of secure a date, I suggest you go on a meetup and try not to come into the meetup with any preconceived notions. So what are some great examples of meetups? Well, a meetup can be something as simple as grabbing a cup of coffee together, walking around the mall or having a trip to a mall, or even working out together. And sometimes even just going for a walk around a neighborhood can be an example of a meetup. The whole point here is, while it can have a small bit of romanticism to it, it's not really looked at as a very romantic type of a date. So what you're doing essentially is you're trying to go on these meetups, very slowly build rapport and value until eventually you can get to stage 7. Stage 7, the romantic date stage. All right, so this one is pretty obvious. Naturally, romantic date stages are dates that you're going on that are romantic. So some of the best examples can include watching a sunset together, going for a moonlit stroll on the beach, going to a theater or comedy show where both of you have to dress up, having a private hot air balloon ride, though that's kind of rare, museums with wines, going horseback riding, watching an opera together, going stargazing, cooking a meal together, having a private wine tasting, going to a private dance class, visiting a planetarium, and even going to an intimate jazz club are all really great examples of romantic dates. Now, something usually interesting happens. If you've been able to stair-step your way to this point, usually the conversation about getting back together and having a reconnection or recovery of that relationship will happen very organically without you having to do too much work at all. But there's still one more stage left, because every once in a while we'll have a client who goes through the entire stages, gets to the romantic date stage, things are going really amazing, but the ex is too afraid of a commitment. And that's where stage 8 comes into play. Stage 8 is all about asking for a commitment. Now this is controversial, because most of our clients tend to be females. And most females are taught that they should never be the one to initiate things. Yet the irony is oftentimes with an avoidant, the avoidant won't want to initiate things either. And so what you have is this weird standoff where the woman feels like, well, I'm not going to initiate because the man should have to initiate. And the avoidant is feeling, well, I'm not going to initiate because I'm scared of getting hurt, or I'm scared of getting lost in this relationship and losing my identity, and then I'll run away. And so what happens is this standoff where no one gets kind of the love that they're seeking. So we've came up with a strategy, if you find yourself in this situation, to kind of improve the odds of getting a commitment, especially if you have a very avoidant person who's very engaging on dates but kind of disappears afterwards. So how does it work? Well, essentially what you need to do is figure out the high point of the date. What is the most romantic point when you're feeling it and when they're feeling it? And essentially, when you highlight this point, when you figure out what this point is, you turn to your ex, bat your eyelashes, and say, "So, what are we?" That's all. And usually, 9 times out of 10, that works. Because they're thinking about it too, they just don't know how to breach it. And the fact that you're taking the first step makes them feel a little safer for them to say, "We're officially together."